thank you again very much for coming along to EcoViews and News. Today we're going to continue our focus on Grassroots Global with another local personality here in Boston. That is to say, he lived for a large part of his life in Brookline, Massachusetts, and we're very fortunate to have him in the area. He's been very active both locally, but especially nationally, on the whole question of bringing attention, public attention, to the misinformation, disinformation, and downright lies that we've been fed by the fossil fuel industry. It's important for that reason to recognize that he's been out in front and, in effect, allowed people to come in behind him and build upon his tradition. I'm speaking particularly of Ross Gelbspan. Ross Gelbspan was for years an editor at the Boston Globe, and in one of his pieces there actually won a Pulitzer Prize for his work of an investigative journalist type, and in fact editing a group of journalists. So I want to look at him as a lifelong journalist and champion for public access to scientific information, because it was his concern that the public wasn't being told what was going on, and that the fossil fuel industry was systematically, not every once in a while, not every other Tuesday or when they got around to it, but systematically distorting the message that was coming through to the American people. It was his investigation in those terms that brought all of the attention that people like Bill McKibben and Jim Hansen and others have now focused upon the false image that Americans have about what's going on. Now, when you hear him speak, he's very forceful about the fact that he's not an environmentalist. He's a professional journalist, and it was in his role as a professional journalist that he got interested in these issues, not as an environmentalist. He still doesn't consider himself primarily an environmentalist. But he began to realize that something much bigger was at stake for America's public and America's survival if the democratic process was being undermined by large industry. And this is what he started to bring attention to. Let's take a look.
I am a journalist, not an environmentalist. I got into this issue because I found out that some scientists were being paid under the table by the coal industry to say nothing's happening to the climate. And I said to myself, if there's this cover-up going on, what are they covering up? And there went the next 10 years of my life. So let me start by offering three sort of large-gauge observations about what we are really facing in terms of climate change. The first is its speed. Global warming has blindsided all of us. It didn't even surface as an issue in the public arena until 1988. That was the year the UN began to form the IPCC. It's the same year Jim Hansen went before Congress to testify that global warming is at hand. Today, a mere 19 years later, scientists are telling us that we are either approaching or already at a point of no return in terms of staving off climate chaos.
Okay, now look at this. He has written this piece. He's a journalist in the writing tradition. He's not a television journalist or a street reporter. He's an editorial journalist, focuses on words, getting the image across, if you need to, with pictures, but focusing on text. This was recognized a few years ago by the importance of an award he was given at Tufts University at the Fletcher School. He was brought on board as the Edward R. Murrow Visiting Faculty Fellow in Environmental Journalism. And Edward R. Murrow is the one who really focused on riveting text. So it's important to look at the text behind his material. Take a look. For example, he's interviewed and been interviewing a lot of environmentalists in his role as a journalist. And in the process, he came to know Paul Epstein, another resident of Brookline, and helped Paul write an article that became a big issue in the national press because it was published in the Washington Post. Look at the way he describes it.
During the course of his work, Paul met a Brookline journalist who lived only a few blocks away. They became friends and collaborators.
I had known Paul Epstein from some previous reporting, and he asked me to collaborate with him on writing a popular piece. So we wrote this piece in the Washington Post. It received a lot of attention. I also got a lot of letters from readers who said, notwithstanding, we don't believe in global warming. And that got me involved with the skeptics, and I read their work.
While covering an obscure utility hearing in Minnesota, Ross began to uncover the truth about the skeptics.
The coal industry flew in four skeptics to testify that global warming wasn't happening. I spoke to the attorney general who was handling these hearings. I asked her to compel these witnesses under oath where their funding was coming from. I was the only reporter in the room, and out comes all this information.
Now that's the key thing. He's the only professional reporter in the room on this hearing in Minnesota, and the fossil fuel industry had paid for the arrival of all these climate denialists and to testify against the global warming evidence. And as an investigative journalist, he approached the attorney general bringing this case and saying, look, you've got to get these people to reveal to the public, on the record, where they're getting funded from. First time this had ever happened. Wow, it's the first time you had a professional journalist covering any of these things. Most of these things are covered in sort of local newspapers, not very interesting hearings on power plants. But he flew from Boston out to Minnesota to follow this, and then he realized that the fossil fuel industry was stacking the deck with people brought in from outside and well-funded by the fossil fuel lobby to ram through these coal-fired plants.
That the coal industry had paid these skeptics about $1 million in a three-year period, and I said, holy cow, if this is what they're covering up, let's see what this is really all about.
What began as a cover article for Harper's turned into a book. Published in 1997, The Heat Is On sounded...
Okay. Published in 1997. This is way ahead of a lot of public campaigns like 350.org or Bill McKibben's efforts on a national stage. Bill actually knew Ross, and it was Ross's information that drew Bill McKibben more directly into working on 350.org. But in 1997, he puts out a very important book called The Heat Is On. Take a look at it, because other books have followed in his footsteps.
The alarm that climate change was real.
Ross's first book was remarkably important because it allowed us to understand what's still the dominant problem here, that the world's fossil fuel barons are willing to spend any amount of money, to keep us misinformed, confused, inactive on the most important question.
On the most important question before the human community. Bill McKibben gives credit right off the bat to Ross for his crucial intervention. In 2003, Amy Goodman started covering these things in an in-depth way on Democracy Now!, and particularly after the Bush administration started to repress the research that was forthcoming from Jim Hansen about these issues. Take a look at her reporting. It's really quite good. Back in 2003, this is 10 years ago, basically.
White House officials have undermined their own government scientists' research into climate change to play down the role of global warming and its impact on the planet. This according to an investigation by the London Observer. Emails and internal government documents obtained by the Observer show that White House officials sought to edit or remove research warning that global warming is a serious problem. Officials have also enlisted the help of conservative lobby groups funded by oil industry to attack government scientists if they produce work that readily accepts pollution as an issue. The disclosure will anger environment campaigners who claim efforts to cut greenhouse gas emissions are being sabotaged because of the administration's links to the oil industry. Both George Bush and Vice President Dick Cheney are former oil executives. National Security Advisor Condoleezza Rice was a director of the oil company Chevron, in fact, had an oil tanker named after her, the Condoleezza Rice. And Commerce Secretary Donald Evans once headed an oil and gas exploration company. The central piece of evidence is the discovery of an email sent to the chief of staff at the White House Council on Environmental Quality by a director of the Competitive Enterprise Institute, known as CEI. CEI is an ultra-conservative lobby group that has received more than $1 million in donations since 1998 from the oil giant Exxon. The email, dated June 3, 2002, reveals how White House officials wanted the CEI's help to play down the impact of a report last summer by the Environmental Protection Agency. In the report, the U.S. admitted for the first time that humans are contributing to global warming. The email also discusses possible tactics for playing down the report and getting rid of EPA officials, including its then head, Christine Todd Whitman. The allegation was denied by the White House and CEI. In June, the New York Times reported the White House had rewritten the report. Kurt Davies of Greenpeace says, quote, "It all fits together. It shows that there's an effort to undermine good science. It all just smells like the oil industry. They're doing everything to allow the U.S. to remain the world's biggest polluter."
Okay. Now, this is back in the heyday of the Bush administration. The Bush, any collaboration with the oil industries through the CEI, the Competitive Enterprise Institute, to try to discredit the reports that government scientists had come forward with. It's just extraordinary. This is the kind of thing that Ross brought to the attention of the world with his clear writing and reporting on this issue. And it's something that deserves a great deal of praise at this point, but also sober reflection, because this was 10 years ago, if you look at it. In fact, this was the time at which Ross was out making speeches around the country, particularly here in New England, but on the end of the summer of 2003, people were beginning to realize that there was a huge problem, because just in the beginning months, in July of 2003, 50,000 people died in Europe of an extraordinary heat wave. Little of that got into the public attention, but Ross was very quick to point out that we needed massive reform of American institutions to be able to take this on, particularly campaign finance, because campaign finance is what was corrupted by the contribution of big oil, big coal, and big gas. Listen to his speech up in New Hampshire at the time, in August of 2003.
I want to talk to you for about 15 minutes about the mother of all environmental problems, but I'd like you to know that it's not just John and Doris who want campaign finance reform. Nature requires campaign finance reform as well, because there is no way we're going to move to clean energy without clean elections. It's sort of hard to get people focused on climate change today because there's so much competition from other problems. We are under attack from terrorists. Our economy is in a period of stagnation, with some economists now talking about deflation. We are very anxious about the aftermath of the Iraq war. So I think it's very important to understand that climate change is not just another problem in this complicated world of proliferating problems. Climate change is the problem which, unchecked, will swamp all other problems. Conversely, I very much believe that the solution to climate change contains the seeds to some of the other most major problems threatening us today. I think a real solution to climate change has the potential to begin to mend a profoundly fractured world. Let me take the example of terrorism. The most obvious connection is that a transition to clean energy would reduce our dependence on oil in the Middle East and reduce our exposure to the political volatility there. A second, more technical connection is that a renewable energy economy with its standalone solar systems and basement fuel cells and regional wind farms would make the electricity grid a far less strategic target for terrorists. Much more important, I think, given the fact that poor countries are much more immediately vulnerable to the impacts of climate change, is the fact that our continuing indifference to climate change, since we generate a quarter of the world's emissions with 5% of its people, will almost guarantee more anti-U.S. terrorist attacks. The real truth about terrorism is that aside from hardening specific targets, airports, and nuclear plants, there is no way to protect a real complex society against terrorism. In the long run, what is really required is a 180-degree turn in our posture toward developing countries. It is a fact that energy investments in poor countries create far more wealth and far more jobs than the same money invested in any other sector. And if the U.S. were to spear a wholesale transfer of clean energy to poor countries, that would do more in the long run to undermine the economic desperation that gives rise to anti-U.S. terrorism than anything else.
Okay, well, you can see 10 years ago, he's pointing to the kind of link with the desperation in third world areas that's emerging with climate issues. The fact that U.S. has done nothing and is breeding the kind of contempt and antagonism that leads to terrorism. The best way to counter it, he says, is to get out there with a green energy plan in the third world. Take a look.
On the economic front, it's very clear that the entire global economy is susceptible to periods of stagnation, and I think history shows us that when you have a really floundering economy, what works is not interest rate cuts and tax reductions. What really works are public works programs. And what we're going to be talking about for a minute is a public works program to rewire the globe with clean energy. Without question, that would be the most productive investment we could make in our future. And within a decade, we would see a worldwide and continuing economic
resurgence is what he then points to, and he goes on to illustrate what's wrong with.
Unintentionally, we have set in motion massive systems of this planet with huge amounts of inertia that have kept this Earth hospitable for 10,000 years. We have heated the deep oceans, we have reversed the carbon cycle by 400,000 years, we've loosed a wave of violent and chaotic weather, we've altered the timing of the seasons. We're living on an increasingly narrow margin of stability, and the evidence is all around us. The urgency on this is spelled out in two recent studies, one from the science side, one from the energy side. The main climate laboratory in Britain 2 years ago found that climate change is happening 50% faster than they originally thought. And that is because they originally calculated the effects of warming on a static biosphere, but when they factored in the warming that's already happened, they found it's compounding, and they basically said that by the year 2040, most of the world's forests will begin to die off and release more carbon.
Now, keep an eye on this. He's an investigative journalist, not focusing initially on climate issues or on the environmental issues, but once he starts to investigate it, he goes after the scientific reports and delivers them in a very clear manner to a public that's still bewildered by these things. Take a look at some of the further statements he makes.
The first consequence of the very small warming that we've seen is basically a forcing of the planet's hydrological cycle. And that's expressing itself in longer droughts, more heat waves, more intense storms, and the fact that we're getting much more of our rain and snow in these intense, severe, very destructive downpours.
Now, he didn't predict Sandy, right? He didn't predict Hurricane Katrina, although this is 2 years before Hurricane Katrina. But he's saying that that's the kind of thing that's coming, because he's reading the scientific reports and now he's delivering it to the public. You can expect more severe droughts, and we've just had one of the most severe droughts this last year in the American Southwest ever recorded since the Dust Bowl. And you can expect severe weather events, the kind of Katrinas and the Sandys, both of which have happened since he made these statements in 2003, 10 years ago. This is why he's out in front and why we should pay attention.
But it's important to understand that climate change is no longer a scientific issue. It represents a titanic clash of interests that threatens the survival of the largest commercial enterprise in history. The oil and coal industries together generate about $2 trillion a year in commerce. The rest of the industrial world is beginning to meet this challenge. Holland has just completed a plan to cut emissions by 80% in 40 years. Tony Blair just committed Britain to cut her emissions by 60% in 50 years. The Germans have committed to 50% cuts in 50 years. By contrast, the position of the Bush administration is truly criminal. The White House has become the East Coast branch office of ExxonMobil and Peabody Coal, and climate change has become the preeminent case study of the contamination of our political system by money.
Okay. Very clear. Right? 10 years ago. It's the case study of the contamination of our political system by money. The carbon industry, basically, has bought the administration at the time, the Bush-Cheney administration, and it's basically so infiltrated the electoral process that Americans can't proceed. Now, Ross retired from the Boston Globe, but he didn't retire from the issue. Just like Jim Hansen, who retired from his NASA position a few weeks ago, has not retired from the issue. Ross, in fact, took it online. He set up a website that you can consult. His book was The Heat Is On. His website is called The Heat Is Online, and you ought to go to it and hear his full statement. It's really quite impressive. You can pull it up from your own computers and watch it at length. He's put it together in a way that's very compelling. This is about a 15-minute presentation, and I'll just give you a particular slice of it here so you can get a sense of the tone.
I am a journalist, not an environmentalist. I didn't get into this issue because I love the trees. I tolerate the trees. I got into this issue because I learned that the coal industry was paying some scientists under the table to say climate change isn't happening. And I said to myself, if there's this cover-up going on, what are they covering up? And there went the next 15 years of my life. So the impulse that propelled me into this work has nothing to do with the love of nature. It comes from a very deeply held belief on which I based a 30-year career that in a democracy we need honest information on which to base our decisions. And in this case, some very powerful interests were stealing our reality. And I know in my bones and from all my experience that bodes very, very badly for the democracy. And it turns out it also bodes very badly for the planet as well. We are standing at the threshold of runaway climate change. And the coming disruptions, which most scientists say are inevitable, will lead us either into a future of totalitarianism or into a new and unprecedented era of human cooperation. But first, a word from our sponsors. This climate crisis has been visited on us by huge coal and oil industries which have blocked any meaningful action on the climate for the last 20 years. Most regrettably, they have a powerful ally in a negligent and largely indifferent U.S. press, which has consistently failed to connect the warming to people whose crops are destroyed by weather extremes, whose homelands are going under from rising sea levels, and whose borders will be overrun by environmental refugees.
Now, that's actually a very important point, one that he makes after retiring from the professional role he had at the Boston Globe. But his indictment is not just the fossil fuel industry, but it's the entire press that basically has been co-opted, as he points out. If you look at his websites, you'll realize that he followed his Heat Is On publication with another one called Boiling Point, How Politicians, Big Oil and Coal, Journalists and Activists Have Fueled the Climate Crisis and What We Can Do to Avert Disaster. He's aiming at journalists here. In fact, you can see this as an emphasis of his Heat Is Online site. U.S. press coverage, a damning betrayal of public trust. A damning betrayal of the public trust. Now, this is exactly what we want to keep you in touch with. Get access to that article. He writes very compellingly. And look at the way he takes on the American press here. It's absolutely crucial. Others have come along with books on the climate cover-up, the Republican War on Science, and Merchants of Doubt, all in this tradition. But you should recognize that Grassroots Global, Ross started this with 15 to 20 years of work on this, and it's something we'll want to keep in touch with. Keep in touch on air or online as we bring you these perspectives.